back to my childhood. This movie did not bring me back to my childhood. There are things I want to address. I just want to get real with you. And to be honest with you, I'm glad I saw the movie again, because in my spoiler-free review, I was like, this is one of those movies where I need to watch it twice before I really process this thing. But the things that pissed me off still pissed me off. But there are things in this movie that are great, and I like those great things. Like the beginning action sequence in this movie, Poe Dameron is in fact a great pilot. And that guy, that commander on the dreadnought ship, he was a dick. He was the best. Dude looked like George C. Scott. He just had a scowl like, of course they are. This guy harkened back to old school Empire. In fact, if you can trade him out with Hux, I'd be fine with that. Yeah, at this point, Hux just kind of annoys me because he screams all the time. Though he did that in The Force Awakens, I just thought there was room for growth. Apparently there's not. So yeah, let's bring that dude into the fold. I feel like that dude would do some straight up damage. He's dead now though, so I guess we won't get him, but I liked him. Poe Dameron calls in the bombers that drop bombs in space because of gravity. I know TIE bombers have already existed, but I always saw TIE bombers as they shoot something, but just vertically down. It's not gravity that does it. It's actually shooting something down. It's how I always saw it anyway. But a lot of people die in here. So I like the fact where it's just like, dude, you can't just blow everything up. Sometimes you just gotta run because there's like 50 of us. We're not big. Then we see Rey going to Luke. Now, this is one of those things where she holds Luke's lightsaber to Luke. Luke grabs it. And the way the music was going, I was like, he's gonna shit can that thing over his shoulder. Totally did. Throws it right over his shoulder, which is pretty much a metaphor for any and all fan theories and expectations for this movie. But that was the first thing I was like, I mean, really look at it. This is Anakin Skywalker's lightsaber. Luke Skywalker had that lightsaber when he fought his father. His father cut his hand off. It fell down a chasm in a cloud city. By all rights, he should never have seen that thing again. But here it is, four decades later, in front of his face. And he's not even the least bit curious. Not like, where did you get this? Even Han Solo asked Maz Kanata where she got it, which we're probably never gonna find out. Maybe in the books. And he just chucks it over his shoulder. I felt like that was a moment where it's like, that could have been a serious moment, and they just sacrificed that for an unexpected laugh, which is very Disney-ified of them. So I just kind of like, is it gonna all be like that? It's not all like that, but moments like that are in it. But I really do like the Rey-Luke dynamic in this movie. There's a good lesson in there about heroes versus reality. Legends versus the person. At one point, Luke is talking about Darth Vader, and Rey's like, you're the Jedi who saved him. He's like, and I became a legend, Luke Skywalker. And it's the whole, like, don't meet your heroes thing, because heroes are not the reality of the situation. They're not the person. In the end, heroes are just people. And people are, in fact, flawed. I really hated that whole casino planet thing. In fact, I hated the whole arc with Finn, Rose. I didn't like any of it. Because you look at it, Finn's like, they're tracking us through hyperspace, which has happened in Battlestar Galactica. But the First Order can track them through hyperspace, so there is a hyperspace tracker, so they need to go to this stupid casino planet, find a hacker, get him back into the ship so they can hack it, so they can't find them when they jump into hyperspace. So they can't be tracked. And in the end, they go to this planet, meet Benicio Del Toro, who is not the hacker they were looking for, but he is a hacker nonetheless, who kind of talks like Roger Rabbit. Then they go back to Snoke's ship to hack it, and they don't end up hacking it at all. So really, the whole thing was just completely useless. How about this? Since you have Rose, a character no one really knows about, how about when Finn's like, oh, they're tracking us through hyperspace, they're going back and forth, and they kind of get the tech? Finn can get them there because he mopped the floors. And maybe Rose is actually a really good hacker. So let's say Finn and Rose just go there, and their arc, instead of being on that casino planet, is actually in Snoke's ship, trying to be stealthy, maybe running into some conflict. Granted, that would be a lot like the Death Star, also the Starkiller base arc with Han, Chewie, Finn. But I think it would be more interesting than that casino planet. It would actually give Rose more relevance, cut out that segment entirely, and maybe be relevant because maybe they'll actually hack it.
Still doesn't change the fact that you wouldn't need a hack, because in the end, the First Order just follows them down to the salt planet. No need to track through hyperspace at all, because there is no saving that arc.
Granted, the illusion of relevance for the hacker comes for when the Resistance is sneaking down to the salt planet. He's the one who was like, hey, they're sneaking down to the salt planet. So then they start picking them off because they were going to be cloaked before. Or you can have a scenario where they're all in that ship. They're like, we're out of gas. They're going to blow us up. Our best chance is to go down to the salt planet. Then the First Order just sees it happen. No need for a hacker to betray him. I mean, I get what they were doing with the casino planet. War profiteering, rich people getting rich on the backs of other people, weaker people, people who get screwed by them, and animal cruelty. Basically, it's just kind of a lens on our civilization as seen in the Star Wars world. If you're going to address a social issue, just at least make it a good storyline. I just don't see things like that. I don't see like, oh, that's a social issue. That makes it good. I just see a plot point that sticks out like a sore thumb, which is such a tragedy because John Boyega is so charismatic. When he's going to that escape pod and he's gonna go get Rey, which is like, I had to zap people escape, and he's like, that's just disgraceful. I was like, he's so good. Why would you waste him in this fashion? And then when you bring on a new character like Rose, why would you waste her? Why not make her the hacker? She would have been more relevant. I don't know, anyhow. It's done, I guess. Then the throwdown with Phasma happens! Really quick fight that then ends because Finn bashes her over the face with that stick that they were gonna kill him with. And she calls him scum, he says rebel scum, she falls down into a fiery pit. Guess she's dead again. Might not be. I imagine she's dead, but I will say they go out of their way to show that her armor can deflect blaster bolts. So if it is heat resistant and possibly impact resistant like vibranium, I'm literally making shit up. I'm just saying, what if it's a sci-fi adventure. Let's say she falls through the fire, lives, gets into a pod. Now she's safe. She could be in the next one. I don't know. Point is, why bring her back to just kill her again? It's like they were like, okay, Phasma didn't get her shine before, so now she's gonna get her not shine again. Maybe Phasma's just useless. We're really trying, though. And in the end, the Finn and Rose thing, which I didn't even see it as a romance until she saves him from that big battering ram thing at the end, which I guess is miniaturized Death Star tech, which I don't know why it has to be miniaturized Death Star tech. Nothing about it really reminded me of the Death Star at all. The way it shot its laser didn't remind me had the Death Star gun? Are we to believe a kyber crystal's in that thing? What's Death Star about it? Why not just say it's a big battering ram that's gonna crack this thing like an egg? That'd be fine. Anyhow, when he's going towards it though, I was like, dude, Finn's dead. He's going to die today. At that point, I was really like, oh man, emotional. And then Rose saves him and Finn goes over there like, that was dumb. What did you do? She's like, I saved you, dummy. That's how we're gonna win. Not by fighting the things we hate, but saving the things we love. Then she does this kiss, this awkward kiss where he's just staring at her. It was almost like an impromptu kiss. I feel like John Boyega looked like he wasn't even expecting. They were like, that takes perfect. It's good. That was a good kiss. Oh, it looked like she kissed her brother. It just did. But even in Star Wars, that can work and have some passion. I'm just saying the moment they flip that thing from a completely useless storyline, story arc in the movie, to a completely forced and terrible romance, I was like, is that the worst romance I've seen in Star Wars? Possibly. Yeah. I'm saying possibly. At least Anakin and Padme look like a couple of young people who wanted to bang. I just don't buy these two. I don't. Leia goes into a coma in the movie, which is funny because I heard she was a huge part of this movie, but she goes into a coma. It's a hull breach. Kylo Ren comes. He's gonna waste Leia. And then he's like, no. And then a couple of TIE fighters just shoot the bridge and suck all of the commanders out. And then she does like the Mary Poppins thing. There's a force bubble that comes around her after she's all frozen. She's like, not force. Feed the bird. That actually kind of reminded me of old Star Wars lore. Like now it's Legends. But before the prequels came out, the story was, Anakin fell into a volcano and the lava was burning him and he created a force bubble where he just stayed alive. So it kind of reminded me of that. So it's ultimately a force bubble that keeps someone alive in an environment that should kill them. Point is, more commanders we all grew up with are dead now. Now we're going to talk about Laura Dern's character. Her name is, I think, Holdo. She just kind of came across in the movie as an asshole who should not be in charge. Granted, I know Poe Dameron really screwed up and he got reprimanded by Leia. He is feeling the burn. A lot of people died. Dude made a dumb call. Shouldn't have done it. Absolutely. Throw him in the brig if you feel like he needs to do it. Guy straight up fucked up and people died. However, right when Poe goes to Holdo and he's like, hey, we just want to know what the plan is. What's going on? She's like, I know you. You're the one Leia demoted, right? Yeah, you're a flyboy. You're a hothead. You're the last thing we need. She literally just opened it up for conflict. I just don't feel like that's what a good leader does. Then for the rest of the movie, he's literally like, we're all gonna die. Can you please tell us the plan? And she doesn't. She doesn't tell him the plan. Why didn't she tell him? Does she think Poe Dameron's a spy? Does she think she's surrounded by spies? In a moment like this where a character keep secrets from another character for no good reason, I feel like they're keeping secrets from us, the audience. They just have to write a way for it to happen. It just comes across like she has shit communication. She's not doing it for the fleet. She's doing it for pride. She doesn't like this guy. This guy's a dick. So she's not going to tell him anything. Yes, this is a military operation. The commanders don't have to tell everybody everything, but he kind of encompasses 1/20th of the fleet you have left. So I feel like a little communication would be pretty good. I just feel like the best leaders I've ever known in real life and fiction just have good communication with their subordinates. She could have just been like, all right, here's the plan. We're just gonna try to outrun them. We're gonna get in the pods. They won't be able to see us with the radar. We're gonna go to that planet. We're gonna hold up and be safe. It's what we got. You know, it would have worked because when Leia told it to Poe, he was like, oh, cool. Yeah, it worked. So the whole conflict was born of the fact that they both wanted to establish dominance above each other. It led to a mutiny, which was also in Battlestar Galactica. It's just the whole thing. It came across as like everybody's a dick. I think Leia should reprimand all of you when she comes out of her coma. However, she does lead to the most visually glorious moment in the entire, possibly in the entire Star Wars saga. That scene where she goes into hyperspace through the ship and just splits all the ships in two. That shit was business. The sound cuts out. It's all black and white. Yep, love that. However, I will argue in a world where it looks like the new way of Star Wars is introduce new characters, kill off all the old ones, introduce new ones, kill them off, kill off some more old ones, introduce new ones, kill them off. I feel like an end like that. All right, here we go. Hypothetical situation. Admiral Ackbar has been a hero in the rebellion for decades. If Admiral Ackbar had met that end, would that be more satisfying? For me, yes. Much better than blowing him out of a hull breach like the
they did.
All the command gone. If he's the one who did the kamikaze run, I just would have felt fulfillment.
At least they sent one of the old characters off well.
But the Rey's lineage thing, I'm not gonna lie, there were two knee-jerk reactions where I was like, well, that was useless setup. Who were Rey's parents and who is Snoke? Watching it a second time, I've ironed them out. Here are my thoughts on it. I like the poetry in the fact that Rey comes from nothing. Because really, a lot of great people don't come from greatness. That they come